Good morning, students. Good morning to all. And last day we have studied about the warehousing and what are the documents are used in these warehousings. Today just we will study the functions of warehousing, and after that we will go to the next lesson also. Functions of warehouses. So what are the functions are providing by the warehouses, or what are the functions are takes place in these warehouses means some of the functions are there. First one is storage. So there is a time gap between the time of production and the time of consumption, and a gap between demand and supply. Normally, if you are producing any of the commodities, that commodities must have some of the gap between the time of production and the time of consumption. And like that, some of the demand of the supply also will be there. Whenever the demand is increased or the demand is raised, on the time only that produced product has to going to the market. But the producers will never wait for the demand arising. So before that he will be able to produce all the commodities in futures demand. But the produced commodities must be protected in any of the places. So we have to store all the produced commodities. So one of the storage purposes is must be needed to protecting all the commodities. So the functions also, the warehouses providing the storage functions. The surplus goods are stored properly for the purpose of supplying them at right place and the right time. So we must increasing the supply of commodities whenever the demand is arised. But till that we have to protect the place in proper way. So the storage, the warehouses also providing the storage facilities for the produced commodities. Next, price stabilization. The price stabilizations also arranged for the purpose of having the warehouses. So warehousing ensures price stabilizations by supplying the goods and when demanded. We will never know about the time of creating the demand for that commodities. But if the time the demand is increased, if you are not able to increase the supply, the price will be increased on the basis of law of demand. Okay. But when we have the warehousing facilities, we can make the storage capacity or the storage purpose of the commodities. All the produced commodities will be stored in this warehousing, and whenever the demand is increased or whenever the demand for one commodity is raised, we can easily come to the commodities in the market. Then because of that, the price will not be able to increase. So it acts as a cushion to absorb price fluctuations and supplies the goods at more or less uniform prices throughout the year. But 1 or 2 days maybe the demand will be there in this market, but within 1 week or within the proper time the supply of commodities will reach to the market. So because of that the price will never increase, the price always will be stabilized throughout the year. Next, equalization of demand and supply. So warehousing equalizes the demand and the supply of goods by storing these goods when they are not demanded and releasing them when there is a demand. So the demand and the supply will always will be equal, because when we have the warehousing facilities, we can easily storage or we can easily store the produced commodities. And whenever the demand is raised at the proper time, at the spot of the time, we can providing the supply of commodities. Then always the demand and the supply will be as equalization. So when the demand and the supply is being in equalization, so there is no need to increasing the price supply. So thus the consumers get the commodities regularly even during the off season periods. Some type of the commodities is produced in this off season only. But when we have the warehousing facilities, we can easily store that commodities, and it will commodities also easily get in the off season also. Next, business finance. So based on the goods deposited in a warehouses, the depositor can get finance from banks and other financial institutions by showing the receipt issued by the warehouse keepers. So when we are stored or when we are stored the commodities in any of the warehouses, we will get, or the producers will get, the warehouse keeper receipt. The warehouse keeper receipt is one of the document is provided by the warehouse keepers. By issuing or by showing this warehouse keeper receipt, we can easily get the financial facilities from any of the financial organizations, maybe in the commercial banks or the agricultural bank or the cooperative bank. In any of the bank, we can get the finance facilities by having the warehouse keeper receipt. Next, risk bearing. So in case of damage to the goods, warehouse keeper compensates the loss caused to the owner of the goods. Thus, the warehouses bear the loss of risk involved in storage of goods. So after submitting the produced commodities to the warehouse keeper, the warehouse keeper will get all the responsibility to protecting the commodities, and the producers or the wholesaler also will be living from the responsibility to protect that commodities. When the goods are stored in this warehousing, the full time the warehouse keeper only will get the responsibilities. Suppose in case any of the deteriorations or damage is arised in the commodities from the warehouse, so the warehouse keeper only will take all the risk. So the risk bearing capacities also will be held by the warehouse. Next, preparation for sale. So modern warehouses undertake the functions of sorting, packing and labeling for the purpose of making the goods suitable for marketing. So hence, warehousing is needed for making the goods suitable for sales. So the wholesaler or the producers will be submitting, or after submitting the produced commodities in this warehouse, the warehouse worker only will be doing all the work such as sorting, packaging and labeling. It will be purpose of making the goods suitable for the marketing. So after creating the, after arising the demand, we will never do any of this work. So when the time of protecting the goods in this warehouse itself, so all the workers will doing the goods. Next, widening the marketing area. So the warehouse also providing, or it will be helpful to widening the marketing area to the producers. A manufacturer can sell the goods to the different marketing areas by establishing branch warehouses or taking the service of rental warehouses at the required places. Thus, warehousing widens the market for the goods. Whenever we have in the need of marketing, the warehouse, so the warehouses always will be built or constructed or located in the nearby the marketplaces. So whenever the extent of the warehousing, the number of warehousing, it will also creating the widening the market area also. Next, value added services. So warehouses also provide certain value added services such as in transit mixing, grading, packaging and labeling. Sometimes goods are repacked and labeled against at the time of inspection by prospective buyers. So whenever we are stored our product, stored our commodities in this warehousing, these all the commodities will get the value added services provided by the warehouse workers. Okay students, then we have completed the chapter 13, warehousing. Now we will go to the chapter 14, transportations. The transport services facilitates the smooth carriage of goods from the place of producers to the place of consumers. The transport, why we are going to study the transportations in this commerce, means the transportations also one of the aid to the commerce. So we must study about the transportations and the need and the functions and the advantages of different type of the transports. The transport also facilitates traveling of people from one place to another place, and the commodities also will going to one place from another one of the place by using the transport facilities only. So according to the K.K. Saxena, he is one of the commercialist persons, he is defined the transport. The transport system act as a act with the reference to the area it serves in the same way as a candle does in a dark room. How one candle is used to the people when we are being in the dark room, like that the transport also using reference to the area, because all the commodities has to be reached in the hands of consumers from the hands of producers. So without having the transport facilities, it is not possible. Then how the produced commodity is going to reach the consumers with the help of different type of the transport only we will studying in the transportation. So the term transport includes all the clerical, mental and manual occupations involved in this operation of road, rail, canal, sea and air transport. Goods have no use unless they are made available at a place where and when they are wanted. Whenever we want to create or arising the demand, that time we have to consume. Otherwise, we have to supply the commodities. The transport is an integral part of commerce. It is a means to carry men and materials from one place to another one of the places for the purpose of consuming any of the commodities. So, next, the types of transports. So, the commodities and the men's also moving from one place to another one of the places by using the different type of the transports. So what are the types of transports are there? First we will study about the surface transport, the earth transport. In the surface transport, the people and goods by land vehicle is known as a surface transport. It is also called as a land transport. So in this land, what type of the transports are used to moving the commodities from one place to another one of the places? First one is pack animals. So animals like horse, mule, donkey, camel and elephant etc. are used for carrying small loads in backward areas like hilly tracks, forest regions and deserts, known as pack animals. Normally are not now. Once upon a time, so all the producers or the sellers are using the pack animals such as the donkey, camel, elephant only to moving the commodity from one place to another one of the places. So generally the pack animals serve area which are inaccessible to modern means of transport. Wherever we are not able to use the modern transports, from where we have to use the pack animals only. So animal transport has also played a significant role where there is no road and railway transport. Still, some of the peoples in this tribal area are using the pack animals only to purchasing or selling the commodities. Next, bullock carts. So it constitutes the predominant form of rural road transport in India for goods traffic and to some extent for the passenger traffic. It links up the villages with the nearby markets and railway stations. It carries the produce for sale to the market and consumer goods to the villages. So bullock carts means another one of the types. I don't know whether we will see or not. But the bullock carts also used in the small rural areas and wherever the producers or the agricultural producers are producing the agricultural product. The agricultural product might have also used in the bulla carts only. Next, road transport. The road transport is one of the most promising and potent means suitable for the short and medium distance. It provides the basic infrastructure for bringing the majority of the people who are living in far-off villages into the mainstream of nations, like by connecting them to the different places. Normally, all the producers and wholesalers are using the road transports only. Wherever the peoples are using their own vehicles and the wholesalers also, those who wholesalers are using their own vehicles, they will using the road transports. If offers, the road transport offers a number of advantages such as flexibility, reliability, speed and door-to-door services besides the supplementing and increasing the efficiency of other modes of transport. So when we are comparing to the other type of the transport, pack animals and bullock carts, the road transports also offering the many advantages. Next, motor lorries and buses. From the dawn of civilizations, the people have been endeavoring to form roads and use wheeled vehicles to facilitate the transport of men and materials. The credit of revolutionizing the road transport of introducing the elements of speed and greater carrying capacity into the system goes to motor lorries and buses. Now all the large scale industries or the large scale producers also using the motor lorries and the buses only to carry their product from one place to another one of the places. Next, tramways. So it made their appearance in the 19th century as a form of transport suitable for big cities. Tramways were initially horse-drawn, later steam-powered and now electrically operated. So this is also one type of or the pioneer form of the railway transports. Next, railway transports. The invention of steam engine by James Watt revolutionized the model of transport all over the world. The railway as a mode of transport is the most organized transport undertaking all over the world. The railways are the cheapest and the quickest means of transport for carrying heavy goods over long distance. If the producers want to transferring the heavy vehicle goods or the heavy goods, the railway transport only is the suitable to transferring them good from one place to another one of the places. But when we are using the railway transport, we have to take some of the advantages and some of the disadvantages also. But railways are well suited for carrying heavy and bulky goods over long distance. But if there is any of the deteriorations or any of the damages or arrests in these goods, we will never claim any of the money from the producers. And it can provide long distance travel throughout the day and night with unbroken services. Next, it can provide better production and safety to the goods than the motor transports. And it has regular schedule of timing and it is available throughout the year. But the same time, some of the disadvantages also is there. So the railway rates are relatively higher than the motor transport for transporting light vehicle articles. But even though the light vehicle goods also have to transferring from one place to another one of the places, but when we are comparing to the cost of vehicle, the cost of goods may be very low. Next, it is inflexible as it is operated to the particular track which cannot deviate from the set routes. We have to arrange another one of the goods to transferring the goods from the railway to market. Next, in rural areas, it cannot offer adequate traffic because of uneconomical operating cost. So the rural people will never get the advantages of the railway transports. And if railways are not fully utilized, and if wagons or coaches are to half empty to its capacity, a heavy financial burden will be cast on the railway. But if any of the producers are using the full rail, the railway department will get the profit. But normally all the people, all the producers will never use the railway for their transports. Next, services of transport to the business. How the transport providing the services to improving the business. So the growth and development in the means of transport over the past 200 years have produced significant economic effects. It has revealed how important are the services of transport. First, if you are taking the services, it increases the efficiency of productions. How transport will increasing the efficiency of production means the object of production is consumption. So without consumption, the producers will not having the need of producing the commodity. But effective transport system creates the time and place utility and thereby influences the demand for goods and the value of goods. Thus, transport makes the production efficient and purposeful. So by using the transport only, the produced commodity is going to reach in the hands of the consumer. So after consuming the produced commodity only, there will be the possible will be created to the next production. So the increase the efficiency of production is provided by the transportation only. Next, variety consumer goods. It stimulates the wants by increasing the quantity and variety consumer goods. So the transport helps in getting commodities which cannot be had or produced in a region due to unsuitable natural conditions. So without adequate and effective transport, goods cannot be had either in the quantities or varieties required in the complex economy. So whenever using the different type of the transports, some of the goods cannot able to produce in our domestic nations. But by using the air transport or the ship transport or the ocean transport, we can get that commodities. So the consumers will be able or will have the chance to consuming the variety types of goods. Next, expand the market. So the primary functions of transport is to enable the physical distribution of goods at global level. So the distribution of goods must take place easily, economically and speedily. It provides the chance of expanding national and international market. So because of the arrival of new commodities, the domestic market also will be extended. Whenever the domestic market is going to expand, so the domestic entrepreneur also will be increased, and because of that, the employment opportunity also will be created. Next, the transport will help in the price stability by distributing goods all over the country. When we are using the transport, we will get all the type of the commodities in the proper time whenever the demand is arised. If there is no transport facilities, we will never get the commodities when the time of demand is arising. So when the demand is arising and if there is no possibilities to increasing the supply of commodities, the price will be increased. So because of the usage of transport only, we will get the all type of commodities in the proper time in all type of the market, and because of that, the price of all type of commodities will be as stabilized or equal or the reasonable. Next, it aids to economic growth. The movement of raw materials, fuel, labor and finished product and the mobility of capital and technical know-how, transport playing a remarkable role in the growth of all industries from agricultural to manufacturing. So normally in all the nations or all the domestic nations also have to be in the situation of depending upon the one sector to another sector. For example, the industrial sector must be depending upon the agricultural sector for their raw materials. So many of the raw materials to the industrial sectors is taken from the agricultural sectors only. So without having the transport facilities, we will never transferring the goods from one place to another one of the places and one sector to another one of the sectors. So not only that, the fuel and some of the labors and the finished product also will be moving from one place to another one of the place, or one nation to another one of the nations, and some of the technical know-how or the technical knowledge also will be transferring from one nation to another one of the nations. Then all the nations' economic also will be developed. So even the lower developed countries also will have the chance to develop. Next, mass production. So the transport will help in specialization and mass productions. The specialization means the divisions of complex process of production into a number of separate processes, so that each person and group specializes in each and every process. It has been extended to international level also. So already we have studied, when we have the goods chance to producing the same commodity, the workers will get the specialized skill. Whenever the raw material or one of the production units are getting the raw materials and getting the possible to produce the same commodities throughout the year, their employee will get the specialized persons. And because of that, that production unit or that industries can have the more possible to increasing the productions. The mass productions will be available into the industries. Next, it encourages in innovations. The transport encourages innovations in product production and designing. So the transport provides plenty of opportunities to the producers to produce their product in the innovative and creative way, to catch up the wider market and reap more profit. So by having the transport facilities, the innovative entrepreneurs are going to encourage, and the innovations also will bring into the commodities on the market. So the innovative commodities also have a chance to catch up the wider market, and they can reap more profit from that organizations. Okay students, so the transport also providing the more services to the business. First one is the efficiency of productions, and we will get the variety of consumer goods. Next, expand the market. Next, the helps in price stability and aids to the economic growth, and the mass productions will be increased, and the innovations, the entrepreneur will increase in their innovations. Okay students, if you have any doubt, please ask me, and just to take the services of transport to business as your study portions. Thank you.